Fun worship this morning, and I think God has got a message for us.
Amen.
So let us come into his presence with thanksgiving in our hearts as we bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, we are so glad to be with you. And whether we are worshiping together here in the church, whether we're worshiping at home in the sanctuary of our living rooms and dens, you are with us, and we thank you. Lord, prepare us for the week ahead. Prepare us by giving us a word of instruction, a word of hope, a word by which to lead our lives. Lift the burdens from our shoulders that we may stand upright and bring joy to our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Okay, I've got a few announcements for you, and while we're doing that, if you have brought a bulletin with you, what? I'm sorry. It is. Oh, it's on my back. Okay, I get it. Yeah, for those of you enjoying watching this comedy here, every time I take my mask off, it takes my microphone off. Can you hear me now? All right. So to get back into it, if you brought a bulletin with you or if you received one, fill out the connection card that's on the inside right-hand side of that. If you didn't, pick out one of these tickets from the pew front in front of you and fill it out. And it's really necessary. We need these for everybody so that in the sad event that there is some sort of a COVID virus and somebody needs to track you down or track us down, we've got the information. Anything that you put on below the first dotted line there, we can tear that off so it can be confidential, but we do need that information. And again, compliments on all of you for wearing your face masks. I'm the only one that, well, and Becky, since we're both up here and isolated by a distance of more than 12 feet, actually considerably more. But the rest of you, thank you so much. It's so important that you do this. Okay, announcements. PACA, Food of the Month. We have not forgotten our neighbors. And do not forget them when you're out at the grocery store, Walmart, Costco, Sam's Club, wherever you go shopping. Pick up some cookie mix or breakfast muffin mix. I got to tell you, back a long time ago, my wife used to get those cheap boxes of blueberry muffin mix. And of all things, they were actually pretty good. And they can really brighten somebody else's day. You know, sometimes we talk about, you know, providing things like beans and rice and boring stuff like that for people. But we remember, too, that they are people. And they enjoy some of the fun things also. So bring that in, put it in the shopping cart downstairs in the Welcome Center, and they will be blessed. Okay, one of the fun things is our tradition here for quite a while has been to do a last Thursday of the month community dinner that is free for all of the community. And after a slight pause, we have resumed that with a delightful drive-through style. And I got to tell you what, this is working so cool. I'm going to set up my grill, and we're going to grill some more burgers out there. We've got a whole assembly line of people right inside the doors that put these dinners together in a nice covered take-home box. And, you know, we've had police officers, sheriff's deputies, EMTs, and members of the community all coming together and driving through. And I got to tell you what, it's so much fun seeing, especially some of you who are at home even right now. It's so much fun seeing your faces and just knowing that you're still with us. So anyway, put the word out, tell your neighbor, tell your friends, but don't you dare miss it. That almost sounds like a ShopSmith commercial. Okay, other announcements. The Reverends Winnie and Charles Munson, if you didn't know, they were both reverends in the Methodist Church. They are celebrating their 65th wedding anniversary together. So, you know, if you think about it, give them a phone call. I don't know if Charles really emails much. I haven't seen anything from that. But give him a phone call, send them a card. As you know, he's struggling caring for Winnie. She is not as mentally sharp as she would prefer to be. And he does a lot of caretaking for her. But they are celebrating. Okay, the September-October Upper Room has arrived. There's some in the Welcome Center downstairs, and there's also some on the table in the Connection Point. So be sure to pick up your new copy for that so you're ready. Fontana Christian Church is sponsoring a women's conference on September 24th. The theme is going to be Battlefield of the Mind. And I sometimes wonder to myself, is that like me? I have arguments with myself and lose. I don't know what it's about, but I think it's going to be good. Cost is $20. Contact Marlene or Shelley if you're interested in that. And then there are a fresh batch of Thinking of You cards out in the parlor. This is our way of reaching out to some of our friends that we haven't seen in a while and making sure that they know that we still know that they're there and that they're important. Those are the announcements I have. Are there some that you would like to add? Not seeing any. This is where we become the church together. Normally during this time we would stand and walk over and shake hands and hugs and greet each other. But I would invite you to stand in place, turn to your neighbors, holler out, wave out, do whatever you want to do to greet them. But this still is a way of coming together as a community and becoming citizens of the kingdom of God. So let's stand and greet one another. Good morning, tech team. Good morning, Becky, Lior. Good morning, church. Come forward and get ready to light the candles. As you remain standing, then, let's get ready for our processional hymn, number 63, Blessed Be the Name.
Blessed be the name.
Get the little.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
And stay standing, and we're going to go right into our opening hymn, number 98, To God Be the Glory. Seated. And I'd invite you to join me in this call to worship. The words will be up on the screen. And for you at home, don't forget to join in also. We want you part of this. Seek the living God who rescues and saves us in times of trial. Seek the living God who renews, transforms, and strengthens us in our hour of need.
Maker of heaven and earth,
we come from different places with our own place on the journey. Some of us have succeeded and found favor. Some of us have failed and seek reassurance. Some of us feel trapped and helpless. Some of us have escaped peril and feel great relief. But no matter what our experiences have been, we come here today to meet you in worship. Remind us of your power and mercy. Replenish our courage and vision. Renew our identity as your people. Reinvigorate our holy work in this world. For our help is in your name alone. Holy God, maker of heaven and earth. Amen. And let us sing together 568, Christ for the World We Sing. Today, and so I think we have children's moment if we can turn to 191, Lior. How are you? You got to remind me, what's your name? James? That's right, because one of the guys in our tech booth who's on vacation today, his name is James also. So I have heard a birdie tell me that there's something in one of these boxes up here. You think I ought to look and see what it is? Or should I just tell a story? Okay, well, they're tired of my stories, so I'll look and see what's in the box. Is it in this one? It rattles around kind of funny. I wonder what the heck it is. Is it a toy car?
Maybe.
How about a hippopotamus? Okay, well, it's not it may be a toy car, but it's not a hippopotamus. Am I getting warm? Well, should I look? Is it something that's going to bite me?
No.
Oh, thank goodness. I had somebody put a live turtle in one time, and I had to tell them, no, they're not allowed to do that. Nothing alive or anything that'll bite me. Ah, look at that. Well, it's, yeah, I was right. Amazing. It's a toy car. In fact, more than that, it's a monster car. You ever watch these things on TV or go out and see them? What's your favorite thing that they do that you like to watch?
Do you hold up your hand and just lift it up?
let's see, he wants me to see if I can flee. He's counting on the fact that maybe I can actually catch it. I did. But yeah, and you know, that's one of the neat things about these is monster cars. So many times they jump over everything else, don't they? And you know, I've often thought, wouldn't it be nice to have a monster car when I'm in a traffic jam and I could just go zooming up over the top of everybody? But then I think to myself, I don't think they would like that very much, would they? But you know, sometimes these monster trucks do things that are impossible for anything else to do. And you know who I'm thinking of that can do things that are impossible? Jesus. You know, there was a talk about going on top of things. There was a time when Jesus, well, it was a dark and stormy night. And there was this big sea out there, and the waves and the wind were blowing. The waves were deep and they were scary. And Jesus' disciples were out in a boat in the middle of it. And the boat was going up and down, and tipping back and forth. And they were scared to death. They thought they were going to capsize and drown. And you know what? The neat thing about it is they were rowing on the oars, and they looked up all of a sudden, and you know who they saw? Well, they said, close. They saw Jesus. He was walking on top of the water. Right there in the Bible, it says so. He walked across the water. And you know, even easier than one of these monster trucks can take and roll up over the top of another car, Jesus was walking across the water. Because nothing is impossible for Jesus. He went out there to where they were, and he held up his hand, and he spoke a word, and the wind stopped. The waves settled right down, and the sea was calm. Nothing is impossible for Jesus. Just as this truck can roll up over all the other things, Jesus can roll over the problems of this world. I don't think even this monster truck could beat Jesus. Although he might like to ride in one. Anyway, we're going to have a word of prayer, okay? Lord God, I pray your biggest blessings on James. I pray that you will be with him always, and that when the problems of his world seem bigger than anything else, that you'll come along and show his problems that you're bigger than they are. Bless him all the days of his life and help him to grow up to be a strong man of faith. Bless him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And sir, you may take your truck back. Here you go. Thank you. And as he runs back to his seat, it is time for us to share our joys and our concerns with God and with one another. And so, what are you joyful about today? Yes.
School started and the kids were so excited to be back. It was great to see you smiling eyes. Because that's all we could see. But it was a joy to be back at school.
Okay, for those of you online, Stacy just shared that it was a joy to be back at school and see all the happy, smiling eyes, because she couldn't see them, their faces, through the face mask. But their shining eyes were there. And we do ask God's blessings on all the teachers and all the kids, because they're going to need it. What other joys do you have this morning? Yes?
John and I have three grandsons in college, starting college.
Suzanne and John have just shared that they've got three grandsons starting college this fall. Hallelujah. Others? Yes, Norma.
I just like to say that Janet Hubert and Don Nelson and I will celebrate our birthday tomorrow.
Wow, happy birthday to you, to Don Nelson, and to Janet Huber. I thought women were always perennially younger. Thank you, Norma. Happy birthday. And happy birthday to y'all that are out there listening. Do we have any other joys? How about concerns? You have some concerns. And while you're thinking of those, I do have several here. Continue to pray for Verna. She has cancer concerns that she needs prayer for, and also we've just learned this morning that her dad has just entered into hospice, so prayers for him and prayers for her also as she adjusts to this new stage in his life. Donna Prothy has shared some very alarming news with us. Five members of the Block Lutheran Church have come down with COVID. And we're not sure if that was because of attending an out-of-town wedding or what it is. I'll be curious to get some more details. But that is very concerning and very sobering news. And also, she wants us to know that her son, Don, is back home. The doctors weren't wild about releasing him just yet, but he really, really wanted to get back home. And so he'll be struggling a little bit, getting accustomed to some new routines and getting around and so forth. So prayers for Donna and prayers for Don. Continued concerns for all in our congregations who are recovering from sicknesses and from surgeries. And are there any others? Not, oh yes. Yes, Joel has just asked for prayers for the people on the Gulf Coast for this unusual phenomenon of twin hurricanes. And I would also remember the people in California that I think over a million acres now have been consumed by fire, including quite a few homes and probably quite a few businesses. Do we have any others? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Loving God, you have created for us such a beautiful world, a world filled with all the resources that every one of us can need. Yet this is still a world in which we have struggles, a world in which we see evidences of evil in various places. A world that still faces natural disasters such as fires and storms. We pray, O Lord, that you will bring gentleness into our world. That especially today for those people on the Gulf Coast facing these twin hurricanes, that you will help them to find places of shelter. That perhaps you will take and calm these storms, even as Jesus did that night when he walked on the waters. And that above all, Lord, you'll keep all of your people safe. For the people in California, many of whom have been displaced or have lost homes, help them, O Lord, to find places of shelter. Help them as a state to be able to repair and to recover. And let your presence be felt there especially. For our nation, Lord, we seem to be, well, in such a state of confusion, even chaos. Speak a word of peace to each person contemplating violence. Speak a word of forbearance to each of those trying to protect others. The law enforcement officers, firefighters, EMTs, all of those who so willingly rush into danger and stand between us and danger, protect them, O Lord. We pray for your healing mercies upon those from our sister church and block, that they might recover quickly and easily from this COVID virus and that they might not spread it to another single person. Help us here in this church to avoid this COVID virus. Help us to be well. And then, Lord, just look upon each one of us. You have heard the prayer concerns lifted up, but each one of us has concerns of our own. And this is our faith and confidence in you, that you know even before we do the burdens we carry, the sicknesses and diseases that ravage our bodies, those things that we worry about. And so, Lord, in silence, knowing that you can hear our deepest thoughts, in silence, we pause and lift up these things to you now. And so, Lord, having heard our prayers, we join together in the great prayer that you taught Jesus' disciples and us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O Lord, are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace.
I would invite Mary Siebert to share God's word in scripture this morning.
Reading from the Old Testament, Leviticus 2:11-13. Every grain offering you bring to the Lord must be made without yeast, for you are not to burn any yeast or honey in a food offering presented to the Lord. You may bring them to the Lord as an offering of the first fruits, but they are not to be offered on the altar as a pleasing aroma. Season all your grain offerings with salt. Do not leave the salt of the covenant of your God out of your grain offerings. Add salt to all your offerings. And would you please rise as you are able for the New Testament reading? And the New Testament reading is from Colossians 2:4-6. I tell you this so that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. For though I am absent from you in body, I am present with you in spirit, and delight to see how disciplined you are and how firm your faith in Christ is. So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him. This has been the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. And I would invite Becky to share with us God's word and song.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. As you may know, I am a person who loves to eat. I've been working super hard over the last six, 8 months or so, trying to lose some of what I have put on by enjoying my habit of loving to eat. And part of the reason that, I struggle with weight so often is because I also love to cook. Anybody here like to cook? I'm seeing a few hands up here, but there ought to be a whole lot more. But you know, one of the things about cooking, and being as I love to cook, is I've actually got about 2 cupboards which are crammed full of all sorts of spices, seasonings, and herbs. And one of my greatest hang-ups is I'll go somewhere, particularly if I go somewhere out of town, or maybe in the few times I've ever gone to a foreign country, man, I want to go into the supermarkets. I want to see what have they got for herbs and seasonings and stuff like that, and I'm always gathering more. I got to tell you, one of the things, though, that I have learned over the years is you don't buy those little bitty jars of seasonings or herbs in the grocery store. Number one, when I cook, I like to cook with lots of seasonings. And you know, rather than spend $4 or $5 for a teeny tiny little jar, I go out to Sam's Club or several other places and I'll get those great big jars. So when I cook, I can put as much of that cumin or oregano or whatever else into the dish that I want. Now the challenge is, though, is that unless I use it up fairly quickly, it's going to get stale, isn't it? I have found over the years that I have to change out even my large containers fairly frequently because all but one of the seasonings loses its flavor. And can anybody guess the one seasoning that never loses its flavor? Salt, exactly. We're going to be talking a lot about salt this morning. That's the parable that we're studying, and indeed, I want to thank Shelley. She's brought several things over I want you to pay attention to. One, we have got something very familiar to you if you're either a deer hunter or a cattleman. We have got this block of salt right here. Now, I know some of the people will put this out so they can near their deer stands so that they can attract the deer. And if we could slide that camera over just a little bit over here, because I want something else to show here. Thank you. The other thing we've got right down here is it's a neat looking light. And believe it or not, this is a salt light. This is an enormous block of salt with a light built up underneath it. And I think it's just perfect for this morning's sermon. And as well, we have got a light here on top of a bushel basket. And we're going to find out all about those sort of things. But I do want to thank Shelley because she's brought some fun things, which always pay attention to what's up on the altar, because unlike me, she puts things on there to remind us of what it is we're studying. Amen indeed. So anyway, we're going to be talking about salt. And yes, of all of the seasonings, it's the one that no matter what, if you leave it up in the cupboard long enough and if moisture gets to it, it may clump up a little bit, but it's still going to be salty. Matter of fact, it's going to be around with us a long time. As my doctor tells me, because I've got a little bit of hypertension, she says, leave the salt alone. It's going to stay with you. I could argue with her, but I've given up. But anyway, it's the one that stays forever. And indeed, in old times, salt was quite a preservative. You know, sailors would salt down their fish, huge barrels full of salt fish. One of the things that I grew up with as a youngster, since my mom was from New England, was the creamed salt cod. You would serve that on a potato or on toast, and actually it was quite delicious. My dad hated it with a passion. Why, I don't know, but I loved it. Of course, they would salt meat. One of our favorite corned beef, it's a means of salting and preserving beef, and so many different things. Even hot sauce, Tabasco hot sauce was made by salting down the little bitty Tabasco peppers in a great big barrel, and they would ferment and kind of do their thing in there. But salt was a powerful preservative. It was also a cleaning agent. Even today, we still use salt sometimes when we're cleaning different kinds of things. So salt is a preservative and a cleansing agent. It's essential for the lives of all sorts of animal life. Indeed, we cannot live without salt, and it seems kind of ridiculous to us to even think of it, because in our country, in our community, salt is everywhere. Doctors, like I said, they're always telling me and they're always telling all of us, lay off of the salt, lay off of the salt. Going to build up. You're going to get high blood pressure. And they're absolutely right. It's so plentiful. You know, 39 cents or so, you can go down to the Queen's Price Chopper and you can get, you know, big containers of salt, and you can salt down everything as liberally, and it brings out the flavor and everything. But we've got to watch out. But the fact is, back even in the early days in our own country, salt was scarce. There's only a few places that you can get salt. And one of the things that the early settlers had to discover, sometimes from the Native Americans, sometimes on their own, was where they could find a source of salt. And sometimes they would take and trek out for a week or so, traveling off to get some salt and bring it back, because if you didn't have salt, you're going to get sick and you're going to die. And so salt was so essential to human life. And even back in Jesus' times, salt was essential. And we think, well, wait a minute, they had the Dead Sea right there, which is the Great Salt Sea. It's probably as much salt in it as our Great Salt Lake out in Utah. But back in those days, it was harder to transport things back and forth. And many of the Roman soldiers were actually paid a particular stipend so that they could purchase the salt that was necessary for them to be part of their regular diet. Anybody know what that was called, that stipend? A salary. Yes. The same exact word, saline, salt, a salary. And even today we use the term, we don't really remember what it means, it uses a different legalistic connotation, but it's from the same root. They were paid a basic salary so they could go out and purchase the salt, which was a very expensive commodity to those areas that didn't have it. So we've got quite a long history with salt, and we'll talk about light also in just a moment. But I want to talk about this thing called a salt covenant. It's something that it maybe occurs maybe two or three times in the entire Bible, and it's kind of obscure. And I actually had to look online and consult with some of the Jewish rabbis who wrote online. I wish they'd speak to me, but it's another matter. But come to find out that salt, because of some of its necessary life-giving properties, but also salt was a part of how people extended hospitality. And to the people in the ancient Near East, hospitality was incredibly important. If a stranger came by and was in need or asked for food or drink, it was unheard of that you would ever refuse it. And of course, salt was one of those things which was precious and necessary. And for them to serve a meal or give a drink and not offer salt at the same time was terrible hospitality, and they'd be ashamed of themselves. This hospitality is a sub-theme for the whole Bible. You may remember the story of Abraham and Sarah when they were in their tent and they look up and they see three strangers. And being good Middle Eastern people, what did they do? They invite them in. They insist that they come in. They want to prepare a meal for them. And of course, you know all the rest of that story, but in the book of Hebrews, it talks about that just a little bit and said, you know, when you entertain a stranger, you may just be entertaining an angel. Because that's what they were, those three, two angels and God. Hospitality. And the salt is a sign and a symbol of that sense of community. So that they weren't even to offer their offerings without a little bit of a dash of salt added into that. That was part of their covenant. And so it's important to know the context of some of these things so that we can actually begin to try and dissect a little bit of this particular there's a little story here. So I'm going to read it now to you from the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled upon." He goes on to say, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people so they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." Salt of the earth, that's one of those expressions that we have used from almost time immemorial. Ah, that Paul Butel, he's a salt of the earth. Well, now, I've known Paul to be a little salty from time to time, but in a good way. But, you know, we've heard this expression, what does it mean to be the salt of the earth? You know, some of us say, well, I mean just to be a good old boy or a good old gal. To be a good person in general. But this is Jesus starting off this expression, "You are the salt of the earth." And he's talking to his disciples and telling them that, number one, this is what they are, but also this is what they shall be and what they shall strive to remain. So we see so many different emphases on the salt here. One, the salt of the covenant, because this is all about a covenant between people and God. It is about a sacred covenant whereby we walk with God and He is our God and we are His people. The salt that is a cleansing agent. And we look to Jesus Christ as being the one to wash away all of our sins. We look at salt as being a preservative, something that preserves us and keeps us going, keeps us fresh. But he talks about, but if a salt loses its saltiness, it's not good for anything, is it? And I've struggled with this a little bit. I mean, I think Jesus is stretching it just a little bit. Because I have never found salt to lose its saltiness. But if the salt is in something and something else comes along and starts leaching it away, starts washing it away, if we let that happen, soon the dish itself may lose its saltiness. And I think that's what Jesus was really trying to refer to here. And in this particular sense, he was telling them, you need to be the salt of the world to bring hope, to bring cleanliness, to bring seasoning to the world. But do not be in the world so much or succumb so much to the ways of the world that you lose your saltiness. That saltiness, which is our faith in God, our trust in God, the Holy Spirit who dwells within each of us who believe in God. You know, we don't subscribe to the once saved, always saved principle. We do expect that God is with us always, but we can lose our salvation if we walk away from God, turn our back on God, and just refuse to listen to God calling us back. That can happen. And that's what happens so many times when we go out into the world and let the temptations of the world overwhelm anything that God has put in us. When we turn our back on God and say, no, God, I'd rather do it my way. I would rather go my own way. I don't need your instructions, your laws, your precepts, or anything else. That's when we begin to lose our saltiness because the things of the world have flowed into us and wash away that salt. And he is telling his disciples, above all else, make sure that you keep your saltiness. And it's those practices, that walking daily with God, that helps us to keep our saltiness, to keep us unique and different, to keep our effectiveness in this world. We keep our saltiness by doing such things as reading the Bible. And I'd ask for a show of hands, but I don't want to embarrass anybody, but I assume everybody here and everybody out there in TV land reads their Bible on a daily basis. How can you know what the Word of God is if you never turn and open up the Word of God? Then once we're starting to read that little bit, we begin to speak to God through our prayers. And amazingly, especially when we come to, you know, confusing little stories like this that Jesus is trying to tell us, you know, if we listen carefully, we'll feel the nudgings and the murmurings of the Holy Spirit as the Spirit himself begins to teach us what that word that we have just read means. We keep our saltiness by being about those tasks that Jesus has set for each one of us. And indeed, some of the times I have felt the closest to God is where I have been off on mission trips or doing things that have helped other people, you know, actually doing things with my hands to be a blessing to others. And I got to tell you what, when I am busy blessing others, God is busy blessing me, and my salt level rises just about up to here. It's so important for us to be doing the things that God is calling us to do. Things that, if we think about it, are really the natural thing to do, the good thing to do, the right thing to do. When a world is spinning out of control, the world needs people like each one of us to do the things that are right so that the world may see and may know and perhaps even yearn to be somewhat like us. Now, the other part of this, of course, is a very similar story, the parable of the light on a hill or the light under a basket. Back in Jesus' times, homes were not quite as wonderful as they are today, you know, where we've got multiple rooms and each room has two or three or four lights. We got night lights, ceiling lights, bedside lights, lights, you name it. We've got lights everywhere, and we walk into a room, we flick on a switch, and we can see everything there. But back in Jesus' times, those homes were much rougher construction, often of mud brick, often sometimes of stone, and they would maybe build one or two rooms in the entire place, and on the rooms that had a couple of, or the houses that had a couple of rooms, sometimes they'd have like a little short wall, divider wall in between, but it wouldn't go all the way, nor would it go all the way up to the ceiling. And what they would often do is those families sometimes had just one little candlelight. Maybe a little bit different holder. Well, she's got that all put together. Maybe a little different holder than this, but this might be all the light that they had. So they would put it up on a high shelf where it could illumine as much as possible the entire house, thereby giving everybody light. And they say you don't hide it on a basket. It talks about a city on a hill hiding. Uh-oh, I got to fix that. So there we go. About a city on a hill trying to hide its lights. And of course, back in the ancient times when you might have marauders, sometimes you would take and put curtains or put hides or something up over the window opening so nobody could see the light and nobody could find you. But Jesus is talking about his light, which is in each of the disciples. That light, which is the Holy Spirit, that light, which is his dwelling within us, and that joy that we have in the Lord. And he tells us, don't hide that light. Shine that light in such a way that all the world may see the light, and perhaps even like moths, flock to that light. We are the light of the world. We are the salt of the earth. We share that light with each person. We show that light by acting as Jesus' disciples, always yearning to do what is right, even when it's inconvenient, even when it's difficult, looking to forgive and offer others hope, and above all, sharing the same gospel that each one of us craves and has grabbed for ourselves. That gospel of salvation, that gospel of forgiveness, that gospel which is the love of God for every single person. So when we shine that light into the world and season it with the salt that is within us, we are affecting the whole world. How I wish that some of these rioters in different places in our country would pause and wonder what qualities about themselves are attracting others to their cause. Then I look at the people who are out there quietly doing good in everything that they do. We all know some of those people. We yearn to be like those people. We hear some of these people eulogized after they have left, and we think to ourselves, wow, that truly was an awesome person who affected the lives of so many in such positive ways. And that, friends, is what we are called to do, to reflect the goodness of Jesus Christ to all the world around. Amen. Lord God, help us never to lose our saltiness. Rather, help us to keep coming back to you that you might fill us to overflowing, so that each person we come by is seasoned. That the light which burns inside of us, which is from your Holy Spirit, might emerge and influence and draw people to you, so that they too might experience your love and gain their salvation in your great kingdom. So fill us, O Lord, with salt and light, and help us to be that for the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue to worship this morning also through our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Remember, this is an important part of what God has called us to do. Not that God needs our dollar bills or our $100 bills, really, but that the world around us needs those. Through our gifts and our offerings, we honor and thank God, and we continue Jesus' mission and ministry in all the world around. So for those of you who are online with us, we've got numerous ways. You can click the little QR code. You'll see that at the end of the service on the final slide. You can mail in checks. You can do online banking. There's a million ways. You know what they are by now because you all have been so faithful in supporting us. So at this time, I receive virtually your tithes, your gifts, your offerings, even as you will put them in the offering plates on your way out. And so I'd invite you to stand and sing with us the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit.
Lord, you are the source of all that we have. You have made it possible for us to bring you these gifts today. And so we bring these thanking you, Lord, for filling us with your Spirit, for loving us, for empowering us. And we bring you these gifts, asking to be part of Jesus' own mission and ministry. Bless, O Lord, these gifts and those who brought them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And as you remain standing, I would invite you to turn to our closing hymn, Go Forth for God. A joy to gather here and worship with you this morning and also with you online. I pray that this has been a time of peace, of renewal and restoration for each of us. I'd like to invite you next week to join with us again. We're going to be focusing on another parable, the parable of the wise and foolish builders, which I have entitled, How Firm a Foundation. I'll let you think about that, and if you would like, turn to Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 29, and you can kind of get a preview if you would like. Anyway, now go forth for God, being the light, being the salt of the world. And go and be a blessing and be blessed. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
art, thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping.